brought to you by Penguin.
Tennis Lessons by Susannah Dickey, read by Louisa Harland.
Prologue.
Throughout your life, you dream about an antique seesaw. You never see it. The you in the dream is sightless, but you know what it looks like, all rusted iron and worn wood, and you can hear it creaking in the dark. It tips on its pivot independently of a person, and there's a wailing sound, like a high-pitched police siren accompanying its movements. You are stuck fast in the blackness, and you can hear the steady thud as each end collides with the ground and the growing intensity of its scream. Eventually, the sound seems to be coming from inside your skull. As a child, you would wake from the dream sweaty and breathless, the sheets bunched into damp creases in your hands. You would run into your mother's room, and she would be alert by the time you reached her bedside. She would kiss your head and rock you back and forth. Your father wouldn't be there. He'd be asleep in the spare bedroom across the landing. The first few times this happened, you asked why, and your mother said, "He's only sleeping in there because he has a cold, and I can't afford to get sick at the moment." As you get older, your mother can't afford to get sick more and more frequently, and the fifth or sixth time you refer to it as Dad's room, she does not correct you. Eventually, you learn to stop waking her. You never learn how to explain what the dream is about. Instead, you stay in bed and try to make sense of your room in the dark. The black blobs of the wardrobe, the wicker chair, the soft toys. The siren fades and swells in your ears.
Part 1. 3 years old, May. You have an enormous ragdoll named Frangipan. She has a round, flat face like a whoopee cushion and hair made of individually sewn in strands of brown thread, the same shade as yours. Her smile is a thin U-shaped capillary and she wears a yellow dress patterned with sunflowers. You adore her. One day you're sitting on the pink rug in your bedroom, twirling her boneless legs around one another. You are also dressed in yellow, and you love that you and Frangipan match. Your mother is sitting on the edge of your bed. She gives all your toys difficult names and then teaches you to sound them out, one syllable at a time. The doorbell sounds and she presses her hands down on her thin knees and pushes herself up from the mattress. When she's gone, you fold Frangipan in two until her permanently shod feet find a home among her hair. You hear the door close and your mother's steps fade as she walks down the hall. You go to the top of the stairs and wait, the doll still contorted in your hands like a briefcase. When your mother emerges from the kitchen, you throw Frangipan. She hits the carpet about a third of the way and tumbles down the rest of the stairs. Your mother, occupied with a letter, jerks her head up, sees the flailing child-sized blur of yellow-clad limbs and brown hair. She careens down the hall, collapses like a clothes horse at the bottom of the staircase. She grips Frangipan in one hand. She stares up at you. 4 years old, March. You are sitting on a carpeted floor in an empty room. There are gloomy, furniture-shaped ghosts on the carpet, marking the spots where the sofa, the armchair, the table used to be. The rest of the carpet is faded by sunlight to the colour of nausea. Only the TV remains. It's squat and chunky, with a huge protuberance out its back, like a skull. The Animals of Farthing Wood is on. Outside, your mother and father are packing the car full of lamps and end tables and boxes of books. The van that had your bed in it has already left. You watched it go with your face pressed against the window. And when you asked your father, "Will I ever see it again?" he laughed so aggressively he dropped a stack of shoeboxes and your mother shouted, "Careful," from the kitchen. On screen, Whistler the heron is carrying a toad in his mouth across a motorway. Your parents are arguing. He carried a large chest of drawers downstairs without waiting for her to help him. What use will you be if you destroy your back lifting things that are far too heavy? Could you at least try to be helpful? Your father says nothing. The smaller animals don't stand a chance, Vixen says to Fox. Your father continues to play Tetris with the car's contents, flattening coats with his hand while squeezing boxes in on top. Kestrel and Oil could carry them over, Fox suggests, and Vixen replies, yes, but they're natural enemies. When the house is emptied, you are put in a booster seat in the back of the car, next to a cardboard box with a picture of a toaster on it that is now inhabited by a kettle. On the drive to the new house, you look out the window at the grassy roadside verges. You think about two hedgehogs flattened under the wheels of a truck. 5 years old, July. An objectionably sunny day spent in a bathroom showroom. Your mother and grandmother, your only living grandparent, are debating the merits of a chrome finish, and you have used up the hours gliding between the rows of toilet seats, stroking the plastic and ceramic and wood. You opted mentally for either the clear plastic, pocked with fusilli-shaped twists of barbed wire, or the one with bubbles and yellow and blue and green fish. Finally, after choosing a single-lever mixer top, your mother selects the ashy blue toilet seat. It has an artificial tree bark pattern, etched lines broken up by painted-on knolls. The oddness of the simulacrum makes you wonder if you're supposed to feel like an animal shitting in the woods. On the walk back to the car, you decide to say loudly, I don't like the one we got. I think it's disgusting. Because disgusting is a word you learned to use with confidence only recently, and because unsolicited honesty is something you're still trying out. Your mother heaves a sigh that seems to travel the length of the car park. In a tired voice, she says, you know, part of being grown up is learning when to keep things to yourself. You sleep on the way home, your head trapped in a triangle of sunlight and your neck bent like a crowbar. You are lodged between your grandmother and the white cardboard box printed with a showroom logo. The box looks like it ought to have a birthday cake inside. All three of you. Your increasingly deaf grandmother, the toilet seat, you are wearing seatbelts. 6 years old, October. Can you spell it, though? H-O-S-P-I-T-A-L. Clever girl. This is how you like your mother best. She seems most relaxed when she's driving, and she seems to like you best when you're learning new words. A muffled ringing noise comes from her handbag. She mutters, blast, and then twists in her seat to show you her exaggerated guilt face. You laugh. She pulls into a lay-by and scrabbles for her phone. Her blonde hair is in two shoulder-length plaits, thin as fingers. She answers the phone. Hi, Joan. And you chew on the straw of your Ibina carton and you swing your feet. She says, yeah. No problem, Joan. I hope it's all okay. Bye-bye. She hangs up the phone and says, what's wrong? Oh, Joan's son had ended things with his fiancée, Molly, for the second time, and apparently it's just so desperately urgent that Joan can't attend the fundraiser tonight. Fiancée? Yes, it means they were going to get married. It's F-I-A-N-C-E-E. Two E's, because she's female, and the first E has a little line over it. Is he sad? Apparently so. Is he? And you pause. And a word appears in your mind. You think hard. Unmollified. Your mother doesn't say anything for a moment. She peers at you. Where did you learn that word?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.